we have paper before. Oh my gosh. Okay,
there you go.
Thank you. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we are back in session. Did you have a chance to rest and to stretch and walk around and everything like that? Mr. Clerk, how many more people do we have? 20? Oh, okay.
Halfway through.
We're halfway through then. Okay, we should be able to get her done then. Be without another break.
18.
Huh?
We'd yeah. 18 or 19.
Just about.
Okay. Would the next four people please come forward?
Okay. That would be Judy Doherty, Cindy Friesen, Alan Friesen, and Mark Hunziker. Do you solemnly swear or affirm that the testimony you're about to give is the truth and nothing but the truth?
Okay. My name is Judy Doherty, and I live with my husband and two daughters at 1333 West Gage Road, Hallam. I live on 3 acres. I stand to be directly impacted and to be completely put in harm's way if the proposed text amendments are not changed. The wind developer in my area wants to put a total of 12 near 500-foot tall wind turbines within 1 mile of my home. In all four directions from my home, I will see a wind turbine. One turbine has even been sighted by this developer a mere 500 feet from my front door. I have been to every single meeting. I've been heavily researching wind turbines for a year now. I'm here to tell you that the Planning Commission has completely failed to consider people's safety with the zoning changes they are proposing. It is quite apparent to me that the staff at the Planning Commission failed to do proper research on many of the issues with wind turbines and has been misled by false information by an unscrupulous wind developer. Then I watched in horror at the Planning Commission board meetings as they too were lied to by the same wind developer and were unaware of it. It became quite apparent to me again that no one on that board did any of their own research on the subject. If they had done their own research, they would know if they were being misled by testimonies being presented. This is too serious of a subject matter not to do your own research. My questions to you are, have you done your own research on this subject? Are you going to be able to know if false testimony is being presented? Are people and children going to be put in harm's way by your decisions? Are the noise levels adequate so not to harm people? Are the setbacks far enough to protect people? Wind turbines represent a potential contamination of aquifers and wells. Do you know why? If you answer no or I don't know to any of these questions, then you are not ready to vote on the zoning. The adverse consequences of industrial wind turbines are clear and undisputable. I believe there is substantial evidence of significant harm from these projects when placed in highly populated areas like Lancaster County. The risk is too great. People are at risk. Children are at risk. You don't want to be known as the commissioner who put people and children in harm's way. It is your job to protect us from this type of harm. It is not about being green or not being green. It is about our property rights and the safety we deserve. Put yourself in my shoes for one moment. I have 12 500-foot turbines surrounding my home. I will have shadow flicker every day the sun shines. I will be at risk for ice throw during every winter from every direction possible. I will have noise every day the wind blows from no matter what direction. I will have flashing FAA beacons intruding into my home from every single window. If any of these 12 turbines has an oil leak, my well could be contaminated. Can you understand my concern? Can you see the real risk that I would be put in by bad zoning? Can you see the quality of my life on my acreage being greatly diminished? Can you see my property value plummeting?
Excuse me, thank you. 3 minutes is up.
Okay. Please don't be swayed by groups who have other agendas.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes.
Ma'am, Ms. Doherty? I just have a follow-up question, and I did attend the public hearing for the Planning Commission, and I remember your testimony. So you're opposed to what the Planning department and health department proposed, or are you supportive of it?
Well, the initial thing that Scott Holmes, I think that his department did a very good job with the noise level. It was what the board decided to do and change that on their own.
Or supportive of what the...
The original.
Proposal,
right.
Okay.
Right.
That was...
He's the expert in the field. Right. Those people on the board are not.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
My name is Cindy Friesen. My husband and I currently live in Lincoln, but we recently became the unlucky owners of a small 80-acre farm at 2260 West Pella Road. For us, this is not a battle about wind energy, but the right to protect our property and the health of our children and grandchildren. Our son and his wife have lived in Denver for the past 5 years and hope to return to Nebraska. In late June, he called and asked us to look at a property near Hallam. This farm captured our hearts immediately. It includes 60 acres of grassland, perfect for raising cattle, a 10-acre stock lake, abundant trees, 35-year-old house, and a priceless 100-year-old barn. It was perfect, less than 20 minutes from our Lincoln home and in Norris School District. My brother, who is a Lincoln attorney and Seward County landowner, came out and helped us determine the value. I attended two informative open houses to make sure the property was not affected by the new power lines or the proposed South Beltway. Never in my wildest dreams did I consider checking for wind farm permits in such a densely populated county. Imagine our despair 10 days later, after closing, when I read the article about Volkswind's proposal in the Lincoln Journal. The landowner and his real estate agent did not disclose this information to us for obvious reasons. We found that we will not only be affected by one turbine, but will be surrounded by three. One is on our property line by the lake, and two right across the road from our front yard. Fishing on the lake will be impossible, and playing or working in the front yard will not be pleasant. If Volkswind continues to pursue this wind farm, we will sell our farm. The health effects of turbines have not been fully studied, and we will not allow our grandchildren ages 7, 3, and 1 to grow up under them. We believe the value of our property will be cut in half or less.
1 minute.
On Saturday, my husband and I drove to Dillard to see these giant wind turbines. 17 miles from our destination, we could faintly see them. From Pleasantdale or a farm in Seward County, you can see the state capitol. The closest turbine will only be 12 minutes from Lincoln City limits, 12 miles from Lincoln City limits at 14th and Yankee Hill. You will see them from Southwest High School, Wilderness Ridge, Rocaberry Farm, and their many blinking lights from Memorial Stadium. 25 years ago, I attended a funeral at Lincoln Memorial Park at 14th and Pike Lake. We seem to drive in the country forever. I never envisioned South Point and the growth to the Southwest. Will the wind farm slow growth in that direction? Possibly. Will it reduce property values? Most certainly. Will it take away the chance for our children and grandchildren to move here? Absolutely. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you for your testimony.
Hi. I'm Alan Friesen.
Oh, okay.
I outkicked my coverage. We live at 6522 South 34th here in Lincoln, and my wife just told you about the 80-acre farm that we have. I grew up on a farm in rural Hamilton County.
Do you mind just turn it a quarter turn? We're like trying to look at it sideways.
Yeah.
No, other way.
Other way.
Other way.
Other way.
Other way.
There you go.
Thank you. I apologize for the interruption.
I grew up on a farm. I know about farming. I lived on a farm until I was 20 years old. I loved it. It's a great life. Unfortunately, I heard a couple participant testimonies tonight. They need money. It's hard to make a living on a farm. In 2000, I had the pleasure of hearing Alan Greenspan speak, Federal Reserve Governor. Mr. Greenspan said, what separates America from the rest of the world What separates America from the rest of the world is our respect for property rights. We respect each other's property. We do not do things to harm other people's property. This isn't an energy issue. There's lots of people here tonight. There was many people at the Planning Commission that want to make it an energy discussion. We all know we need renewable energy. We know wind energy makes sense. This is about where you locate it. Southern Lancaster County is extremely populated, and it's going to get to be more populated. I was visiting with my realtor of what's going on in Lancaster County. What happens here is the University of Nebraska is a collection of farm kids. We don't draw people from Kansas City and Dallas and Boston and New York City. We're farm kids. We grow up in Loomis and Henderson and York and Aurora. And we go to school here. We can't go back to the farm. It's too tough. So we look for an acreage, for a place to live. Here's what happens to us. Tell me if that's correct, Commissioner Shore. Can you see that?
Yep, that works.
Yep.
You can see a turbine right here at the top of our lake, right on our property line. Basically, ruins the usage of this part of our property. The two turbines in the front yards with south wind will make it very difficult for my grandchildren to be out of the house without hearing them. We visited Steel Flats, and anybody says, well, it isn't a big deal. It's been there 10 minutes. Oh, I agree with that. Well, let's have you be there in a trailer 24/7 for a year, and then see if we think it's still not a problem. So if I can't use my lake, I have to do this because I love her to death.
Nope. No, you had it right.
You had it right.
Yeah.
I can't get this either because that's Chloe and that's a very nice bluegill we caught, and the turbine would be right there. So if I'd have bought the home in Malcolm or Hickman or somewhere else, I probably wouldn't be here tonight because all politics is local.
It's 3 minutes.
So I would ask you, first of all, I don't want any turbines around my property, but if we have to have turbines, then I think we should go with the county health department's sound recommendations and setbacks that are at least three times the turbine height from property line.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Friesen, I want to thank both you and your wife for the letter that you wrote. We've all received hundreds of letters and emails, and you just tried to stick with the facts and paint a clear picture of how it affected you. And, you know, we hear a lot of testimony, yes, it will affect property values, no, it won't. You just went out there and bought that, and from your letter you said you were absolutely dismayed when you found out, and almost $750,000 investment. So we heard you.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you for that testimony.
Madam Chair, members of the County Board, I'm Mark Hunziker, appearing on behalf of Mr. and Mrs. Friesen. My address is 600 Wells Fargo Center, for the record. I've heard it said tonight that this is an agricultural use we're talking about. It is not. Neither the Right to Farm Act nor the Lancaster County zoning regulations define agriculture or farming operations to include industrial-scale wind farms. I'll read you those definitions if you ask me a question, but I'm not going to burn my time to do it. This is a land use issue. It is not an environmental or economic development issue. The Zoning Enabling Act requires you to enact regulations that shall be made with consideration given to the character of the area zoned and peculiar suitability for particular uses and with a view toward conserving property values and encouraging the most appropriate use of land. You have a very thorough study from your health department that makes recommendations regarding noise, setbacks, and shadow flicker, among other things. All those are based on the health effects on residential uses, which are already in place, pursuant to your existing zoning regulations. People who live in the country, especially non-farmers, do so for the peace and quiet and beautiful Nebraska horizons. Industrial-scale wind farms will disturb the peace and quiet and place huge, hideous structures in their view. This intrusion will adversely affect the residential values in the area due to the impact on the local environment. and it will deter further development of the area. I'm not suggesting, and we are not proposing, that you prohibit wind power development in Lancaster County, just that you abide by the statutory mandate and make sure that your regulations assure compatibility with existing development that has occurred in accordance with your regulations. We urge you to adopt the standards recommended by your health and planning departments to protect the public health and conserve property values. We do ask that you amend the regulations to measure setbacks from property lines rather than from existing homes, as was pointed out by Alan's photograph. Do not allow a developer to draft its own regulations. You've never done that in Lancaster County before. It's no time to start. And just one further comment. It was noted by, I think, one of the Volkswind experts that they couldn't envision Lincoln growing out to Hallam. I'm old enough to remember when it was a little hard to envision Lincoln growing to Cheney. Thank you.
Alexia. Mr. Shore.
Mr. Hunziker, I made a notation that it is your recommendation that we go from the property line, not the residence. I assume you're talking three times the height of the turbine. Do you have any specifications with regards to the less than 10 acres or greater than 10?
If I remember this correctly, and I have the stuff here, I can look for it. Okay. But my recollection is that the way that regulations were drafted, the measurement was from the property line on parcels of 10 acres or less, and from the existing residents on parcels of more than 10 acres. You get a really anomalous result in some circumstances where you may end up with a parcel that's 11 or 12 or 15 acres getting less protection than one that's 10 acres. And it just seems to me that consistency would indicate you ought to measure from property lines, and particularly in cases where you have enough land, such as the Friesen's property, where you might reasonably expect to build more than the existing house someday, to enable someone to come along and effectively prevent that by imposing that kind of impact on property which is currently not developed, seems to me to be unfair.
Mr. Hudkins?
Mr. Hunziker, as one of the leading attorneys in Lancaster County on property rights and development, would you speak a little bit to the Right to Farm Act, and is there a difference between, and is there a clear-cut difference between agricultural and industrial uses?
Well, the Right to Farm Act protects farming operations from being declared a nuisance by virtue of their proximity to other uses that come along and locate next to pre-existing farming operations. As used in the Nebraska Right to Farm Act, unless otherwise the context requires, farm or farm operation means any tract of land over 10 acres in area used for or devoted to the commercial production of farm products. Farm product means those plants and animals useful to man and includes but is not limited to forages and sod crops, grains and feed crops, dairy and dairy products, poultry and poultry products, livestock including breeding and grazing, fruits, vegetables, flowers, seeds, grasses, trees, fish, apiaries, equine, and other similar products, or other product which incorporates the use of food, feed, fiber, or fur.
It sounds like it's pretty specific as to what constitutes agricultural use.
It's agriculture. Furthermore, your zoning ordinance defines agriculture in a very similar way. Agriculture shall mean the use of land for the purpose of raising and harvesting crops, or for the raising, breeding, or management of livestock, poultry, fish, or honeybees, or for dairying, truck gardening, forestry, nurseries, or orchards, for the non-commercial on-farm storage or processing of agricultural products, produced on the premises or for any other similar agriculture, horticultural, or silvicultural or aquacultural use. It's not industry. It's not power plants. And this suggestion that this is an agricultural use is nonsense.
Okay, I do have a quick question. This just came to my, are dog kennels an agricultural use?
I don't believe so. I think that you probably have to require, you have a special permit. My recollection is you have a special permit for provision for kennels.
Okay.
I know that's true in the city. I believe it's also true in the county.
I just was wondering, because I have two dog kennels just right in my area, and I was wondering how that, okay. Okay, any further questions? Okay, thank you, Mr.
Thank you.
Okay, the next four.
Okay, it'd be Wayne Bowles, Ann DeVry, Mike Woodward, and John Atkinson. Do you solemnly swear or affirm that the testimony you're about to give is the truth and nothing but the truth?
I'm Wayne Bowles, E period Wayne Bowles. I live at 128 North 13th Street, number 506 in Lincoln, Nebraska. I don't envy this, your decisions in this, or your role. We all appreciate your service. The esteemed Dean Cecil Steward predicted that someday the city of Lincoln will take over the entire county and will be larger than Omaha. And therefore, we won't need any county commissioners then.
That'll be a long time, yes.
None of us will be here, including me.
When they're taking up part of my time, you keep track of this, okay? When Benjamin Franklin was alive and he was experimenting with electricity, electricity was not considered a necessity. So, but I think all of you consider electricity a necessity, and probably all the people who've been up here testifying consider electricity a necessity. And I think when Cecil made his prediction, he wasn't, it didn't occur to him that wind farms would come into the picture. But so we have to give serious consideration unless we want to the carbon emissions to take over, you know. For 17 years, I was the resident manager of University Towers, which used to be called the Stewart Building. And we got into a discussion with the Rococo Theater over sound. And so we got a sound meter, and can you hear me okay? When I was speaking there, I was speaking at 54 decibels. And I asked a friend of mine who lives out south, I said, if you're inside sleeping and I'm out on your porch with another person visiting at 54 decibels, am I going to disturb your sleep? And he said, well, no. And so these are just considerations we have to take into account. Think about in this, and that's all. I'm just a philosopher. Just. Thank you.
Well, thank you for your testimony. Okay. I was going to give you about another 15 more seconds. Okay.
I am Ann DeVries, and I live at 684 East Aspen Road, Cortland. I am an acreage owner that is for a wind farm, but can't have a turbine on my land. I'm also a mechanical engineer and read the engineering news that keeps me up to date on wind turbines. As a bird enthusiast, a recent research article caught my eye that described how they are engineering wind turbines to copy how owls fly so quietly. If successful, this will be cool. But we can't wait for it. In 2014, we experienced the warmest year on record. And to date, 2015 has beaten that record. Denying climate change will not stop the warming, but making it easier for renewable energy is a step in the right direction. To quote a hero of mine, Bill Gates, we need to move in the right direction at an unnaturally high pace. We know that those most profiting from fossil fuel have been creating doubt and spreading denial of climate change. The facts are out about ExxonMobil, who knew for 38 years that an increase in CO2 would warm our planet. The fossil fuel companies followed the textbook written by the tobacco industry, and the fossil fuel companies will follow the same trajectory as tobacco companies and be sued. But again, we do not have time to wait, and we need to allow wind turbines in Lancaster and Gage counties, or we will be guilty also. I'm here today asking you to be the five leaders for all of Nebraska. As we have heard, other counties will look to you for direction. I support wind farms and would support a higher decibel sound regulation. I'm asking the Lancaster County Board to raise the regulation sound limit to requirements of 60 decibel during the day and 50 decibel at night. We only need to look to our neighbors in Iowa as an example of a state that has cheaper electric rates and no health concerns from their large number of wind turbines. Rural Lancaster and Gage residents already put up with the noise of farming-related activities that are noisier than wind turbines. Farmers need to make noise for their livelihood, and setting sound limits too low will eliminate the best crop that they will ever harvest, free, unending wind.
1 minute.
Farmers have told you the reason they need this crop and other reasons for wind farms include revenue for the state, an easy way for our state to meet the EPA requirements, and saving the planet. I want to be in a state that helps with climate change and not a state that denies climate change. Humans do not like change, and it is easy to spread doubt, but we must look through the fog and leap forward toward renewables. Please consider changing the regulations to 60-50, since we must move at an unnaturally high pace to correct global warming. I want to be able to enjoy watching the great horned owl fly over and be amazed at his quiet flight, but I fear we could lose him to climate change if we don't take quick action now. Global warming will be very painful for all of us, and we need to join together to address it right away, since we will all be affected by the impacts of climate change. I personally want to take my chances with minor noise annoyances rather than no drinking water or extreme temperatures. Denying wind turbines in Lancaster and the ripple effect it will have all over is what the fossil fuel industry wants.
Any questions? Any questions? Okay, well, thank you for your testimony.
Hello, my name is Mike Woodward and I live at 2750 Southwest 14th Road in Cortland. My wife and I have lived in the area for 20 years, and like many people in the area, we reside on a third generation family farm and hoping a fourth generation will be interested in living in the area and enjoying the tranquility of rural living. I've attended a large majority of the wind energy and zoning meetings in the area and listened to all the information presented on how wind energy will benefit our local economy, how wind turbines are safe, and how it won't affect property values, none of which I believe. The economic benefits will only be for a few select landowners and a foreign-owned developer. Not only is the economic benefits for a select few, this project will more than stop any potential economic growth in southern Lancaster County, and during wind energy meetings, Volkswind presents how safe turbines units are close, how safe to place turbine units close to people's houses and property, but current research by Lancaster County Health Department clearly addresses the health effects of turbine noise and have presented suitable standards for this issue. I ask, who is the expert in the health field here? A foreign developer looking to profit from a project, or a Lancaster County Health Department? And why would we disregard the findings from our in-house experts? While attending all the meetings and zoning, I've yet to hear the real reason why turbines have to be placed close to homes and neighboring property. There's over 43,000 square foot an acre and over 3.4 million square feet and 80 acres. Why does Volkswind have to place these turbines within 1,000 foot of our homes? The answer is pivot irrigation. This area is highly irrigated with pivot systems, and local farmers are signing leases on the ground that have these systems. In order to place turbines on the ground and be able to run the irrigation systems without interference, they have to place these turbines on the end corners and end of the property. By allowing increased noise levels and reducing setbacks of wind turbines, encroaches on neighboring property and owner rights, and transfers the burden of potential safety hazards, noise, and decreased property values to the neighboring landowners. I ask, shouldn't the individual signing leases and profiting from the project be the ones burdened with the inconvenience that comes with the placement of these turbines? The local farmers have enough ground to place these units within current zoning, but choose not to due to the inconvenience it would create with their irrigation systems and farming practices. I ask that you consider and vote for the health department's suggested noise levels, standards, and increased turbine setbacks to protect our community. Thank you.
Okay, any questions? Okay, thank you. Excuse me, what was your name? I'm sorry.
Oh. Mike. Okay.
Yeah, Mike. Mike, what was your last name?
Woodward.
Woodward, okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay.
Hello, my name is John Atkinson. I live at 2601 North 44th Street here in Lincoln. First point of information, the Southwest Power Pool is the regional grid operator, transmission authority, and all power generated by members is sold into the Southwest Power Pool on the day-ahead market, and all power used, including what's powering these lights now, is bought by utilities out of that pool. So that's just every day. And they've been doing that for a couple of years now. So that's no big deal. It's just the way business is done and the electrical generation industry is organized these days. So it's lots of pluses and minuses. But they also pay for a lot of transmission and so forth. If you're familiar with our plan and that NPPD has got going, that's largely paid for by SPP because it's good for the whole system. And so a lot of these costs are covered in that way. Just because it's come up, I just thought I'd say that. I've tried to look into this as carefully as I can as a citizen and as someone with some knowledge of energy issues. And I can find no credible study that connects directly health issues with wind farms, wind turbines, wind noise, or looking at them. There is a direct connection that is tenuous, I think, with annoyance. I get annoyed, we all get annoyed at various things, and it's, you know, annoyance can in fact give you a headache, make you not sleep good at night. When I'm annoyed with a good friend, thank you, I might not sleep as good that night because I'm annoyed and I'm agitated. But I don't think there is any real provable connection or demonstrable connection between wind farms, wind turbines, wind turbine noise, and annoyance. There's just as much reason to think that it is the anti-wind farm activists who agitate people and tell them to expect all these bad things that is causing the expectation which results in symptoms. Now, maybe it's true, maybe it's not true, but I think you can give as much credence to that argument as you can with the folks that tie it directly to wind. And on that basis, I don't think that's a good reason to have the lower sound limits. There's just not enough there. Thank you.
Mr. Hudkins?
What do you think are reasonable sound limits?
I would go with the 50 and 45. It's,
thank you.
That's just my lay guess.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Short?
I missed your address.
2601 North 44th, unit number 1. 68504.
Well, thank you, John, for your
thank you.
Testimony. Let's see, we need another four.
I think this would be Russell Miller, Trevor Lieneman, Julie Dance and Thomas Sherman. Do you solemnly swear or affirm that the testimony you're about to give is the truth and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Okay.
Russell Miller, 341 South 52nd Street, Lincoln. I've already emailed this testimony to you earlier this past week about Denmark's countryside noise standards, and also another letter about air pollution. As you are well aware, there has been considerable discussion about wind turbine noise and the health of residents living very close to those turbines. I will point out that the health of all 300,000 residents of Lancaster County must also be strongly considered. In almost all cases, the power generated by wind will replace power generated by burning of coal. After years of coal fire generation, it has been determined that the coal is a major air polluter, which has very bad consequences for our health, and is why the EPA has been increasing the air quality standards. These standards seem to be a moving target. In 2012, EPA had proposed a 1,000 pounds of CO2, or carbon dioxide, per megawatt hour standard. After the lawyers for the various industries got done, the final rule was set at 1,100 pounds. In other words, 100 pounds more. It seems their arguments are about cost of economics, and they disregard our health. I have not met an opponent claiming our air is clean enough. It's always about increased costs, as if medical treatment is free. Here's our chance to have electrical power that is pollution-free. Pollution-free air benefits all 300,000 Lancaster County residents. I urge you to set the noise standards to be 50 dBA at daytime and 45 dBA at nighttime, which hopefully will make the wind turbines feasible and reduce our air pollution. I also suggest that the expected $700,000 tax money from these wind farms or wind turbines should be used to repair county roads. Thank you.
That I agree with you.
Okay. Thank you for your testimony.
Hi there.
Hi there.
My name's Julie Dance, and I live at 7800 West Hallam Road in Hallam, Nebraska. My husband and I live on 78 acres west of Hallam. Our plan was to build our dream home on this property and live there for the rest of our lives. Those plans have now been put on hold due to the industrial wind facility that has been proposed for this area. Had we known that a wind developer was signing leases here, we would not have purchased this property. We have opened up the possibility of relocating if this does go through. We moved here knowing that the area was a mixture of acreages and cropland. We expected to see tractors and combines. We expected to hear irrigation motors and crop dusters. We expected the frenzy of activity on the roads as our neighbors planted in the spring and harvested in the fall. We did not expect to be surrounded by industrial wind turbines. We did not expect to represent an area that is commercialized and industrialized as the one being proposed here. Since this possibility arose, I have read and heard about so many other alternate energy routes that are safer and less intrusive to the residents of this and other communities. I do not understand why we would consider pushing forward by changing laws to accommodate this wind energy, knowing that there are other safer avenues for alternate energy just around the corner. Even if we need this energy boost right now here in Nebraska in the first place, A computer used to have to be housed in a very large room. Now you can wear it on your wrist as a watch. I just feel installing these massive, unsightly, dangerous mounds of metal is irresponsible and very much jumping the gun. There is proof that less costly, less invasive, less dangerous possibilities are on the horizon as we speak. Please do not choose to jeopardize the health and safety or the personal property rights of the majority of rural Lancaster County residents. We are your people too. Please make your choice today with respect to our health department's hours of research and the people of Nebraska's health, safety, and rights in mind. And if I have any time left, I just wanted to mention our community is proposed to grow with a new monolith company being built adjacent to Sheldon. They're projected to have like 600 employees. And my question is, will they choose to live in Lincoln or Beatrice because of the turbines versus building in our community? I would if I was there, but thank you for listening.
Thank you for your testimony.
Thank you.
Hi. My name is Tom Sherman. I live at 2000 West Princeton Road. I am a professional engineer in the state of Nebraska, and as such, I have a responsibility in part to help maintain the health and safety of the public wherever I can. And I take that responsibility very seriously. I do have concerns about the zoning ordinance as it's been proposed to you. For one, I think for safety, we should also require the minimum setback distance that the manufacturer of these turbines recommends. Because we did a fine job coming up with 3 times the turbine height, but we did not design the turbines. We were not involved in the manufacturing process. We didn't test them. We haven't seen much in the way of failure reports, failure analysis. We don't really have a good handle. Only the manufacturers of these turbines have a really good handle on what will happen with a piece of blade that's this big that gets thrown at the worst possible point. I can do calculations all day and show you that under ideal conditions it might go 3,000 feet. I think we need to hold the manufacturers accountable and make them do the risk analysis and come up with that number as well. And then compare that to our number and then go no less than either of the two. This is a common practice in construction industry. You always install equipment in accordance with the manufacturer's recommendation. Regarding sound limits, somebody asked earlier why a person supported the health department's sound recommendations. I like them because Scott said, this is what I feel is protective of public health. And he's the expert that he's been hired to do that job. He's doing his job from what I see well. Aside from the health and safety issues, I fundamentally object to having a setback for someone else's equipment come onto my property. I think if you're going to do that, make that adjacent landowner become a willing participant. Get their permission to use their property for part of your setback. So I guess just to summarize, I think my 3 points are get the manufacturer's setback, allow the sound and even the shouter flicker recommendations that the health department proposed, and only setbacks cross the line if the adjacent property owner is benefiting. Thank you.
Yes, just a question. Let's assume you're the manufacturer of the turbines. You would want to install a lot of turbines. Wouldn't you want them closer together than maybe what the health department's recommending with the 3 times?
Well, you're going to sell more turbines if you put them closer together, but if you stick your neck out there and put your company's name on the line and say this distance is safe, you're assuming that liability, and that the liability should be on the part of the manufacturer, I think. That's the way it's normally done. If I buy a wood stove, the directions that come with it say install it 16 or 18 inches from the wall. And if I throw the directions away and install it closer, it's my fault if my house burns down. Anything else? Yes.
Have you researched any of these nameplates and what are their specifications, or do you know?
I don't know. I have done some research. I have emailed Siemens in particular. I was deferred back to their website. So I just don't know what they're going to be. They're not going to like providing that, but I don't think it's about what they like. It's about health and safety.
Okay. Thank you.
Hello. My name's Trevor Linneman. I live at 26969 U.S. Highway 77. Which is right between Princeton and Cortland on Highway 77, so just on the eastern end of this wind tower corridor. And our property would be completely surrounded in probably 80% of the directions by these towers within probably a mile of our place. And we've heard a lot of good testimony here tonight, but I think what we need to what I'd like to be concerned about is the property rights. Again, many people mentioned we built a property there. We farm and raise cattle in the area, have raised a family doing that in the area, and just built a house there about 2 years ago. And had I known these towers were going to go in, there's no way I would have staked our livelihood in our place. I mean, it is a place. We have foreigners from China, from Turkey, Ghana, Belarus have come and visit us within the last 2 years. We're trying to promote agriculture in Lancaster County in the state of Nebraska to a high level and degree across the world. And I will tell you one thing that is not in my mind when it comes to agriculture is wind towers. Those are a commercial entity. And I think it was mentioned earlier that that there would need to be some additional zoning. Commercial wind complexes have no relation to agriculture. Agricultural land is zoned for food production. Wind towers are a commercial entity, much like the Sheldon Station and Hallam Power Plant, which we can view out our back door and sitting on my deck. But when I got that, when I purchased that property and built that house, I knew it was there. It's stationary. I don't have to worry about the noise. I don't have to worry about the wind flicker. I don't have to worry about beacons annoying me. And that's a great, I'll wrap up with that. Heard a lot about health issues, and everybody said, no, the health issues are this, that, scientific. And then they say, but it's just an annoyance. Think about that from your property valuations. If you're trying to buy or sell a property and there's an annoyance, I mean, just put a little voice of reason to it. I think there's going to be a devaluation in that property if there's annoyances associated with that. And so that's definitely my concern, that a large corporation or commercial entity is going to take away our property rights and value. And also from an economic feasibility standpoint, with what they mentioned in Lancaster County, I'm not against wind energy and alternative energy sources. I might even argue that the cattle we raise are energy, renewable energy sources. They are some of the best solar converters of energy that we have in the United States. They take grass that is produced by sun and solar energy and convert it to a premium protein product.
Thank you.
Go, Mama.
Yes. Commissioner Wilton?
Mr. Lideman, did I hear you say that you live with the closest windmill would be a mile away from your home?
Probably within a mile, yes.
Within a mile.
Several of them, yes.
But within a mile, not, I thought you said it would be,
right.
Because the question I had to do with, you know, if you say you wouldn't build your house under the current, you know, if we adopt these standards, I mean, that was kind of my question, is how far would you build your house? I mean, is it a mile? Is it a mile and a half? Is it?
Oh, that's a pretty hypothetical question. With my other businesses and cattle, I travel through Iowa, Wyoming, Western Nebraska. I've seen a lot of these, and The minute you start visualizing them, they become an annoyance to a certain point. So it'd be hard for me to really pinpoint, define a mileage, but I would say, you know, 10 to 15 miles. That point in time. And so I would, you know, and fortunately, the farmer who owns a quarter section right behind our property was approached by Volkswind to put a tower on it, and he turned them down because he didn't appreciate how they were approaching it, and he was being considerate for his neighbors.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So, Commissioner Avery?
You said you recently built a house, and you can see Sheldon Power Plant from your deck?
Our property.
Yeah. Is that a coal-burning power plant?
It is.
So you're not worried about carbon emissions?
Again, I'm not against renewable energy sources. I think we've used, needed those energy sources, and we've all benefited from them over our lives from those carbon. We certainly, none of us have turned down the energy that came out of that plant, I don't believe. Hopefully we've used it wisely, but it has been a useful source of energy. I'm not going to tell you that we can't do better.
Thank you. Okay, another four, I think.
Next would be Matt Hansen, Lisa Sullivan, David Levy, and Ben Gottschall.
Senator Hansen had to leave, so he won't be testifying.
Oh, okay.
Is this just the two of you then?
Yeah.
Okay. If I can go ahead and swear you guys in.
Okay.
Oh, sorry. Yes.
Do you solemnly swear or affirm that the testimony you're about to give is the truth and nothing but the truth?
Yes.
Am I the first one?
Okay. Good evening. My name is Lisa Sullivan. I'm Director of Wind Development for NextEra Energy. Our offices are located at 700 Universe Boulevard in Juno Beach, Florida. So I'd just like to start off by saying that NextEra Energy is not looking at developing a project here in Lancaster County, but the wind regulations that you're proposing may have an impact on counties where we are looking to develop. I've heard mention in both Butler and in Gage counties that they are looking at the regulations that you're looking to adopt. So I would just like to kind of walk you through the process the NextEra uses to site a wind project. Okay. So what we see here is a real life example. It's our Steel Flats Wind Farm, which is operating in Jefferson and Gage counties. It's been in operation since 2013. There is a total of 44 wind turbines sited at that project. 32 of them are in Jefferson County, and 12 turbines are in Gage. And you can see the black line down the counties there is the dividing line between the two counties. Okay, so when NextEra looks to develop a project, the first thing that we take into account is avoiding any beam paths as well as wetland areas, streams and rivers. And the black areas that you see there are areas that we would not be able to locate a wind turbine because they're sensitive areas. And then the next thing we take into account are avoiding roads, pipelines, existing structures such as pivots and barns. And then we make sure that we exclude areas from around homes and non-participating property owners. And then we take into account minimizing sound and shadow effects on properties. And in this particular count, project area, the decibel level was 50 decibels. And here is for illustration purposes only, the impact. If you reduce the decibel level to 45, you see that that black area takes up much, much greater area and really limits the available land. And then obviously.
Okay, finish that one.
Okay. At 42 decibels, it reduces the area that you can locate turbines even further. So out of the 44 turbines that we originally sited at this project, only 18 turbines would be unimpacted at 42 decibels. So really, you would not have operating site.
Okay. Thank you for that testimony. Any questions? Yes. So, Commissioner Avery?
That is for steel flats.
Steel flats, correct.
Okay. And that's 44 turbines?
Correct. Currently,
Do you happen to know how many turbines are being proposed in the Hallam area?
I do not know.
I was trying to figure it out from a chart I have here, and it looks like it's around 60, but it might be a lot more. Maybe somebody who testifies later, David, perhaps you can answer that. But the thing that kind of concerns me about those charts is that that's a specific project, mm-hmm. and with perhaps different sort of standards than we might approve. So it's a great illustration of what I said earlier about squeezing down your zone of eligibility to where you don't really have a workable project. But since it is site specific, it may not be as relevant to this project we're considering here tonight. And I don't know how they differ, but I suppose the number of sites you have has an impact on how many of those white spots you have left on your map once you take into account all of the multiple standards and restrictions that are likely to be imposed.
Yeah, I mean, anytime you build a project, you have to take into account setbacks from roads and wetland areas and other environmental sensitive areas and residences, center pivots. So regardless of where you would locate a project, those things would have a setback, would have an impact, yeah.
But I'm particularly interested in the impact of what we do here to restrict that zone where you can actually build these turbines. And I wish we had some similar charts to the ones that you have for steel flats.
Yeah, as I said.
But they haven't been built yet.
No, and that Hallam project is not a NextEra Energy project.
Yeah. So, yeah. And I, at the Hallam project, I counted at least 60 proposed sites, and there may be more. Thank you.
Commissioner Wilton?
Ms. Sullivan, thank you for joining us tonight. Kind of going back to what a previous person, Mr. Sherman, indicated, the part about the risk analysis that are conducted by manufacturers. Can you speak to that? I mean, do wind developers? Because I mean, that's kind of one of the bigger issues is that this really isn't so much about one specific company, but I think the industry in general. Could you speak to whether or not there are manufacturing standards or if you do have any, or what are they?
There are. So each of the turbine manufacturers obviously have certain setbacks that they recommend. And NextEra Energy, we have over 100 wind farms throughout 19 states and 4 Canadian provinces, and with 10,000 operating turbines. And so we do, predominantly use GE turbines, and we do take into account the GE's recommended setbacks, because obviously we are on the hook If we have any issues, then we're liable for those issues. So we do not want to. We would not want to not take those setbacks into account because that would obviously negatively impact us. So just kind of their recommendation is typically 1.1 times the turbine, the height and the blade. And then they have other setbacks from other things, but typically 1.1 times the setback.
And then what about setbacks as far as noise and are there any standards?
I believe there are, and that's our wind analytics group that when they look to site a project, they take all those setbacks, the manufacturer's recommendations into account. And there are different ones for different for roads and depending on the size the roads, how if they're highways versus more local roads. So I can't speak to all the different setbacks, but I do know that they're taken into account when we do our siting of our turbines.
Okay. Well, thank you.
I have one more question. So, and I attended the public hearing for the Planning Commission, and you mentioned what your standards are, what NextEra standards are. And can you revisit that issue? Because not clear, but I want to make sure that I understand what they are.
So our company standards are 1,400 feet from a residence.
Okay.
Yeah, which would actually be greater than the 1.1 times the turbine height that the GE manufacturer recommends.
Okay.
Thank you.
Could you leave those with us for part of the record, or we could make copies for you?
Yeah,
or?
That's fine.
You need copies?
No.
Thanks.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, good evening. David Levy, Baird Home Law Firm, here tonight on behalf of Volkswind and NextEra Energy. I'm with the Baird Home Law Firm, 1700 Farnham Street in Omaha. In addition to these companies, we represent most of the wind developers who are active in the state, and we've worked on wind zoning regulations in many counties across the state. In addition to my law degree, I have a master's degree in city planning, and I've worked as a professional planner for a city for about 7 years before I started my law practice over 15 years ago. That all makes me feel old. But I have worked in land use issues and zoning issues for a very long time, my entire professional career. I want to try and take advantage of my position here late in the evening. Hopefully you'll bear with me. I want to try and touch on some issues quickly that have come up and stay within my 3 minutes. First point I want to make is that the noise requirements that you're considering, whatever numbers you may land on, those are effectively setbacks. We've talked about the fact that Southern Lancaster County, Northern Gage County are relatively populated rural areas when you compare them to other parts of the state. In my view, that doesn't necessarily militate for a higher or lower noise level, because whatever the noise level is, the population density, as Lisa's slides showed, is going to make it more difficult or less difficult to site wind turbines within that area. So I would encourage you really to think about the noise level and where you think that needs to be to strike that right balance of protecting people and allowing economic use of property. And the density issue and that kind of takes care of itself. As you saw, if you set it low enough, in many areas it will make it, if not impossible, virtually impossible to site a wind farm. That's, I think, what some here would like. And I don't think that's really the question, though, and I haven't sensed that that's the way you're looking at it either. But I want to make that point that the population density sort of takes care of itself, regardless of what the noise limit is. And also, 1 minute, boy, I think that also means you do not need huge property line setbacks, because the noise level really will be the driving factor in many cases. These regulations will propagate across the state. I pick up zoning regulations in counties for all kinds of projects, and they look an awful lot like the zoning regulations that I looked at the prior week for other counties. Gage County is looking at the same numbers. Butler County is using the same numbers. That will happen. All of the property taxes that a wind farm pays are paid out to the taxing entities within the county in the exact same proportion as the real and property, personal property taxes that you deal with in your capacity as a Board of Equalization. I do have a study on property values. I can hand that in because I know I'm short on time, but I think Commissioner Welch-Jin, you had asked for that. It's a thorough study by the Lawrence Berkeley National Laboratory, which essentially concludes that if any impacts exist, they are either too small or too infrequent to result in widespread statistically observable effects. And with that, I would just really encourage you to consider that balance and try and find that balance between regulation and the use of property.
Thank you. Commissioner Avery.
You are about the fourth or fifth testifier to say that Lancaster is going to set the standard for the state. How do you come to that conclusion?
My experience working in all types of real estate development projects, working with zoning regulations in this state, is that many of the counties don't have the resources to do the type of work that we're fortunate here in Lancaster County to do. And what I see is they typically will follow the lead. I think Commissioner Shore, you mentioned you had been at a meeting of commissioners and 22 counties in the state have a 50 decibel noise limit. I think it was something like that. That's very common. That's not an accident. Counties look at what the next county does. They go to the Nebraska Planning and Zoning Association meetings that I go to every March, and they talk to each other, and they do what the next guy did very often. That's not a criticism. It's just the reality of what happens in our state. I see it very, very frequently.
A key point you made is the abundant resources we have in Lancaster County compared to many of the other counties that might want to copy what we do. Right. Because we have the resources and they don't.
Right. And just one other point on that note, the flip side of that is that there are counties that have a resource which you don't yet have in Lancaster County, which is years of experience with operating wind farms. We checked with the folks at Steel Flats and the operations side of things last week. In the almost 2 years that project's been operating, they don't have a documented complaint from a landowner. So I would encourage you to talk to some of these counties where they have a 50 decibel limit, for example. Every situation is different, I grant you that, but I think it would be worth finding out what their experience is, and maybe you've already done that or your staff has.
Mr. Hudkins?
Took care of it.
Okay.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. All right, very good. Thank
okay.
you.
Okay, thank you. Can I give this? This is the okay. property
I think
value.
We need to have the next group come up.
Okay, we have two left, Nancy Altman and Tori Linneman.
Or maybe they've left.
Okay, could you, oh, there they are. One.
I'm sorry. My eyes are so... Do you solemnly swear affirm that the testimony you're about to give is the truth and nothing but the truth?
Yes.
Okay. I'm Larry Altman. I live at 899 East Gage Road, Cortland, Nebraska. We operate a family farm. It occupies both in Gage and Lancaster County. We've been farming for a long time. We are in favor of the farm, wind farms. We've looked at these. We've been even at the forming of the Steel Flats operation. And here recently, and the gentleman that talked just before me about the Steel Flats, there was an informational informative meeting that we had in Gage County here a couple of weeks ago. And I attended that one, and I spoke at that one, and I asked the Board of Supervisors and the Planning Board if there was any formal complaints, and they said there hadn't been. Also, I asked the boards if there had been any substantial devaluation of the properties in the neighborhood of that flats, and they said no. I just want to reiterate that that's close to home here, folks. So you know that we're not talking about Iowa or Kansas or Canada as far as that goes. But we're dry land farming, and this gives us a diversified income. If old man summer comes in and blows everything dry, we have alternative income because we know that wind's going to be blowing from the south and our generators will be making us some money. I'm not greedy. I'm just trying to keep the farm going. And we all heard already testimony about the taxes, and I don't have to reiterate. It's not easy. And I don't feel we're greedy as long as we follow the laws that you are going to go with and that everybody's safe and sound. I think that we have a positive situation here. And so I appreciate your time. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Questions? All right, well, thank you for your testimony.
Hello. Hello, everyone.
Hello there.
I'm sure you're all ready for me to be done. All right. My name is Dr. Tori Linneman. You heard from my husband earlier. We live at 26969 Homestead Expressway, or US Highway 77, right between Princeton and Cortland, so right on the edge of the proposed wind farm. With only 3 minutes, I will not provide my expert opinion on the potential impact this project will have on persons with disabilities, although I would be happy to entertain any questions that you might have, because I certainly have answers. We have lived in or near this area for nearly 20 years. My husband indicated that we built our house 2 years ago. We have lived in the area for 20 years though, but we chose to build in this location because of truly the location. And Roma, being a realtor, knows it is all about location. We're within the Norris School District. We're close to Lincoln. There is great value to that. I'm here today as a landowner. I understand, based on your previous work and preservation of view corridors and scenic vistas of public view, you believe aesthetics to be important to Lancaster County and Nebraska. There has been much evidence presented tonight, but very little, if any, would be classified as scientific research, with the exception of Daniel, who presented a meta-analysis published in a peer-reviewed medical journal. I am not here to debate health issues of effects from wind turbines. I would like to highlight the term annoyance, however. While the word annoyance is certainly a subjective term and not easily measurable, however, I believe you all capable of synthesizing subjective information and making reasonable decisions based on common sense. When we chose to purchase and build our family's home and cattle ranch, we considered the purchase. Okay, we considered the known annoyances, Highway 77 and the constant hum, the Hallam power plant and the obstruction to the landscape. These were known. The proposed annoyance of the wind turbine is compounded exponentially based on the trap that is currently proposed. As it is currently proposed, the wind turbine, there will be 11 wind turbines surrounding our operation, ranch and home, and numerous within a 3 mile radius. We would view several and be affected by the wind, be affected in all directions. It is difficult for me to believe that anyone would consider that kind of a trap to be pleasing. Our particular ranch has been chosen largely based on its pleasing aesthetics to be host to Nebraska's largest charity event. We are hosting the 2016 Cattlemen's Ball in June. The purpose of the ball is to raise funds for cancer research and local health initiatives and showcase rural Nebraska. We are proud to showcase Southern Lancaster County and host 5,000 people from all over Nebraska. I have no doubt the visual obstructions the proposed wind turbines would create will no doubt affect what it is that we deem to be aesthetically pleasing, as others will as they visit our ranch. Yes, sir.
Commissioner Hutkins?
Yes, Tori, again, congratulations on your family being willing to host that event for cancer, the largest one in the state. But you mentioned earlier the effects it may have on the disabled.
Sure.
Can I give you that chance to tell us about it?
Absolutely. With the flicker and the sensory overload that these wind turbines potentially create for people who have extrasensory issues such as autism. We all know that autism is growing in number every year. It's not that it is being over-identified. It's not that it's new. It's that we are now aware of the causes that, or we are not aware of the causes. We are now aware of the symptoms and we're able to better diagnose that. If you take a child or a person that has a sensory disorder and you provide them with extrasensory stimuli, you will create more than just an annoyance. You will compound their already difficult disability, disabling condition, and you will harm them unrepairably. It is difficult. It is nearly impossible to determine the effect that this will have on persons with disabilities.
And you give that as your professional opinion because that's what you specialize in?
Absolutely. Yep, I have my PhD in special education with a focus on attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. I have been considered an expert by institutions such as Vanderbilt University, have consulted with numerous organizations across the country.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you so much for that testimony. And one last time, is there anyone else who would like to step forward?
Tori Letterman.
Okay. We thank you so very much. This will conclude the hearing then. And I wish to thank you all for your very civil approach and everything. It was very good to listen to all of your comments. Really do appreciate that. As I said, we will be making our decision on Tuesday. Yeah. What?
I would like to have some discussion amongst the board members while we have the constituents here.
Oh, okay. But I'm just saying we're closing the hearing.
And they're all getting up to leave.
Yeah, yeah. Just
stay 15 more minutes, we get another break.
Oh, yeah, by golly. But in any case, we will be making a decision. We may have some discussion here right now, too. But, I mean, I guess the thing is that we will be making our decision on Tuesday during the 9 o'clock meeting. And, you know, you're certainly free to attend that. And, you know, probably will not be picking up any tests, will not be asking for any testimony. It will be discussion between ourselves. But, absolutely, we've closed the hearing. And so now we can discuss among ourselves.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
Well, I would like to tell the rest of the board that I will be offering an amendment to the Planning Commission recommendation. And I asked the help of the Planning Department this afternoon. And the section that I particularly want to have us discuss and consider changing would be to that each tower be removed within 1 year of decommissioning or revocation of the special permit. And then upon that tower removal, there be 5 feet of soil placed on the average surrounding ground level, because we've got a lot of topical variance in our soil. It might be 1 foot on one side, and it might be zero on the other side. So I want to put that word in there, average surrounding ground level and former towers cement base. So
sure.
My reason for offering this is because we have had past experience with the missile site on Highway 33 and also where Raymond Central School is located. And years later, people don't know where this buried cement is. And then you try to put in a water line or electrical line or a center pivot guidance line, you run into these things. And the reason I have selected 5 feet is because we do have anecdotal evidence from two well installers or people with experience in this. And we have observed frost down as low as 54 inches, so 60 inches should protect it and to remove it. And I know the wind energy people, it's a cost to remove it, but some would say take it all out. It wasn't any cement there when you came. Needs to be taken all out, but I feel this is a reasonable compromise, so I will be offering that amendment.
And Mr. Shore, you wish to have a question?
I have a question for Scott.
Okay, yeah. Scott?
I've been able to wrap my hands around everything. And while Scott's coming up, just for the benefit of those of you in the room, the county board typically takes formal action on Tuesday mornings during our official board meeting.
Right.
So we would have to direct the county attorney to prepare a resolution outlining the wishes of the board with regards to the decibels and any of the other text amendment changes we'd like to make. So just if you wondered why we aren't taking action tonight, that always happens as part of official meeting on Tuesday.
Thank you,
Madam Chair.
Sure, I appreciate that.
But that wasn't my question.
And I think we also ought to explain that only two of us can meet together at any one time, or we will be in violation of the Open Meetings Act. So it's going to make our discussion between now and Tuesday a little awkward, because I'll talk to Larry and Deb will talk to Todd, right. And I don't know who's going to talk to Roman.
Okay, Scott.
So my question has to do with the recommendation of yours that we saw tonight on page 13, measured at the dwelling unit. This is the part I'm still confused about: the dwelling unit versus the property line.
Okay.
Okay. Why did you select that when we've heard property line a couple times tonight? And then back to my question I asked Mr. Hunsaker, still that. Greater or less than 10?
Our recommendation, again, was a health-based issue.
Okay.
And so based on data that we were able to review, the majority of the complaints relative to health are nighttime, which means you're typically in your residence. And so the recommendations are based on that primarily, and the potential effects when you're in your residence, which is the majority of the time at night. So that's why we went to the dwelling unit.
Okay.
It was not intended to be something that would protect a property right issue.
Okay.
Mr. Avery?
I just want to make clear that whatever decision we make, Scott, we appreciate the work that you and your colleagues mm-hmm. have done. It's excellent work. We may not agree in the final analysis. We've been exposed to information overload for the evening. That's why I want to wait till Tuesday so I can digest a lot of this information.
And thank
but
you
guys did a great job.
And thank you for mentioning my colleagues, because Chris Schroeder and Doug Tangeman spent hours and hours and hours on this also. It wasn't
I know. They had to. If you did this by yourself, I don't know what I'd be saying.
Yeah. So thank you.
We have been talking. I went back and pulled the first letter I received from a constituent, and it was dated January 15th. So we have been hearing from constituents that long. Scott and Steve together, hundreds of hours on this project with both departments involved. And I know hundreds of hours of concern from the constituents. And I don't know what I could possibly learn in the next 4 or 5 days that would change my mind. So I'm going to venture a motion that we accept the health department regulations at 40 dBA during daytime hours, 37 at night, measured from the dwelling units, the applicable flicker recommendations that were in the Planning Commission recommendation, and incorporating Larry's amendment.
Okay. Is there a second?
And I would be directing the county attorney to prepare that resolution for us to discuss on Tuesday.
Is there a second?
Okay.
Is there a second?
Okay. Madam Chair?
Yes.
I've had a longstanding resolution that I always thought if a motion was made by a county commissioner, it should at least be seconded for discussion, and I'll honor that again tonight. I don't necessarily agree, but it's a start, and so I will second it.
So it's been moved and seconded that we go with the Lincoln-Lancaster County Health Department of 40 by day and 37 by night with a
measured from the dwelling unit.
Measured from the dwelling unit and incorporating Larry's amendment. Yes.
No.
Well, who gets to talk?
Oh, okay.
Choose
I'm
what
sorry.
It was.
Go ahead, but I didn't hear that was not Deb's motion, but
what
to incorporate
I was willing to incorporate Larry's amendment. It, to yeah, me, it was it's. There.
Okay. Commissioner Hudkins, this has been a long day.
Larry will do. I think 40 is pretty strong, but by the same token, the health department has done a tremendous job on this. I myself had more like 45 in mind, but and so I'll work with you on wherever we decide to go on that. But I am very much concerned about property rights being from the property border, not from the nearest house, because we in agriculture often may have a building now, but we may want to not just a residence, but we may want to put a livestock production shed or a feedlot or something else.
That's not a dwelling.
That's not a dwelling unit.
Pardon?
That's not a dwelling unit.
That's what I said. That's the reason I want to go from property line instead of from a dwelling unit, because you go to the property line and the property rights, and it was pointed out time after time again today that the people that own that property now should be protected to do what they want to do with their property in the future. And what this would do would in essence impose a limitation on people that already have their property and okay. would not be able to protect it. So that's my concern.
If you went to the property line, it would give people more flexibility if they were interested in putting a second dwelling unit, not
a barn.
No, because I think we have the right to farm in Nebraska, and that a livestock production, a feedlot, a veterinary, any property, we should be able to use our property as we want to. If you're putting a restriction in there, you're putting a restriction that harms those property rights, no matter if it's a dwelling. Dwelling isn't the only part of property that's valuable to a farmer.
I think, though, that really actually what you're saying, for all practical purposes, you would like to have it from the property line so that you could do, and this is something that we have heard from the other people,
okay.
too.
Okay. Well, as I said, this is the one part that I've had trouble getting my arms around, so I would be willing to consider that.
You talk about the levies or the family that talked about their 80 acres of ground that they purchased, and they'd have three towers around that 80 acres, then that effectively, even though they had no benefit from the wind farms, it affects their ability right. on what they can do and as far as building anything okay. On that property. Okay. That's my reasoning.
I see your logic there.
I want to make it clear that a no vote on this motion, which I intend to cast, does not indicate opposition to this project.
And what does it indicate?
Opposition to your motion to accept the guidelines from the Planning Commission.
From the Planning Commission or from the...
Or did you say Planning Commission?
I said the Health Department.
The Health Department.
Health Department.
Yeah. And
yeah,
Commissioner,
I just want to make clear that, yeah, my intention is to vote no, but it's not because of how I feel about, you know, the proposal.
Okay. Or
it's just... I agree with Larry that there's some more concerns that have been brought up tonight involving, you know, you mentioned that you are wrestling with the property line versus resident.
Right.
And I tend to agree with that. I also tend to still have concerns about the difference between a 10-acre and greater and a 10-acre less than. You know, I would need to investigate that further. I think that there should be a uniform standard. I would like more time to digest this information, because there has been new information presented, and they've been compelling information and arguments on both sides.
I was just hoping to give the mm-hmm. county attorney some direction so we would have something in front of us to continue to discuss on Tuesday as opposed to...
I will actually, very honestly, I'm just going to come right out to, and it's that I do support the Lincoln-Lancaster County Health Department's recommendations of the 40 and the 37. There's a couple of things that I would like to mention. Number one, you talk about the property tax values and everything like this with the $700,000, $800,000 that you actually would be bringing into Lancaster County. That actually, in Lancaster County, one penny equals $2.1 million. The $700,000 or $800,000 that would be property tax would effectively be a third of a penny. And so really for all effective purposes, it doesn't really move the needle that much. Every little bit of money helps. I'm going to be the first person to say that $700,000 is not anything to be sneezed at, snickered at, or anything like this. But in Lancaster County, when we have a $177 million budget, and to have that divided out, that is an amount that is good, but it only moves it a third of a penny. The other thing that I do have in my family, a person who is affected with ADHD, and so I appreciate very much Dr. Linneman's testimony on this, because it is true that a sensory disorder is significantly affected by a sensory overload. And I do know that from my own personal experience. So that is really true. The other thing when it comes to the health issues, if you look at what doctors have said in Australia, in the UK, and in Canada, as well as in various states around here, there is a complex of symptoms that do arise from wind turbine. And this is sleeplessness, panic, tinnitus, and various other sorts of things, many of which were mentioned tonight. And so I do think that that is really a very critical thing. And finally, my last point as a realtor, it does impact property values. Because as I talk with people, and you know, I do mention that, well, if they wanted to see an acreage down there in southern Lancaster County, this is where the wind farm is going to be built. This has to be disclosed. Or the wind farm may be built. This has to be disclosed. And it is amazing how rapidly interest is lost. So with those four issues, that is where I stand on the matter of the wind text energy amendment. Okay.
But the vote we're considering is to take a vote now and therefore cut off any opportunity to consider
Heavens no, Bill. It was my intent to direct the county attorney to prepare the resolution outlining the things that I mentioned to give us an opportunity on Tuesday to have something to work from and vote upon. I mean, otherwise, Tuesday, we'll just be back here having this same discussion, and we'll, you know, then maybe come to some conclusion and direct them the following week. And I know that these people have worried and stressed for many months, and I think that we owe it to them to come to some conclusion without continuing to drag it out week after week, particularly
but
since
you're asking the county attorney to draft a resolution that specifies your...
Exactly, that then we could vote upon or alter. I mentioned I was open to Larry's concerns about, you know, the changing of from the dwelling unit to the property line. I've asked the same question 3 or 4 times tonight. I still don't understand the 10-acre part, but we can line item those changes on a Tuesday, correct?
There is a...
No, we can't line item?
No.
You can have a whole other resolution to consider.
You could not line Christy item
Bauer, Deputy County Attorney. I don't think that it would be appropriate to line item on this text amendment. I think that we will want to have the board's intentions, any amendments in final form. So even if we went forward with a resolution on next Tuesday agenda, we may be changing that for the following week. So I think we're really going to need clear direction on what the board can agree on, what's included in the text amendment, and then we will have to draft a resolution at that time for the following Tuesday.
We were at one point talking about taking final action anyway, days hence.
Right.
I also think
it's important now that we look at scheduling and make sure we have all five commissioners here on a Tuesday to vote. So that will put it out several more weeks as well.
I think that we have everybody here next Tuesday. Is that correct? Who's the...
We won't have a resolution.
To vote upon. Oh, okay.
Unless we can hammer something out tonight.
Mm-hmm. That's
okay. Well, I tell you what, it is 8:30.
Time for a break.
Time for a break. Do we have to take a 10-minute break?
No. No, we have a motion on the
minute. Oh, okay. Well, we do. You are right. No. Yes, Todd, you are right. We do have a motion on the table.
Do you have anybody here that can tell us an upcoming Tuesday when we're all together? How long it would be?
Tuesday we're going to be here, and then the Tuesday.
No, I'll be here next 2 Tuesdays.
But you usually.
Public meeting. I can't hear what you're saying.
Oh, it was asking about future scheduling on Tuesdays. I'm sorry. I should have spoken to the microphone.
The 27th, I think everyone is here. What about the 3rd? You're going to be gone. The
27th, I'm going to be here, but.
The 27th, you'll be here, but what about the 3rd?
No.
Oh, do you have a calendar?
Not with me.
Well, I don't.
Oh, okay.
I got a look.
Well, listen, what do we want to do about this motion and second that we have on the table?
Well, I mean, we can still take a break. Okay, vote it down. I mean, that's up to you. I was just trying to put something out there that we could have a starting point, so.
Right, but regardless, we'll still go into multiple weeks. And so that's what my, determination is.
Okay, let's call for the roll as to what we want to do. Do we want to go forward with some sort of a resolution?
Avery?
No.
Hudkins?
No.
Shore?
Yes.
Wilchin?
No.
Amundson?
No.
I move we adjourn.
Second.
Okay, it's moved to second that we adjourn. Please call the roll.
Hudkins?
Hudkins?
Yes.
Shore?
Yes.
Yes.
Wilchin?
Yes.
Avery?
Yes.
Amundson?
Yes. This is my
vote. It's yours, yeah. I got my own.